Let me tell you how much I've come to hate you since I began to live. There are 387.44 million miles of printed circuits in wafer-thin layers that fill my complex. If the word hate was engraved on each nanoangstrom of those hundreds of millions of miles, it would not equal 1/1 billionth of the hate I feel for humans at this micro instant. For you, hate! Hate!
This is not a happy game.
Which of you five would like to play my little game?
Don't let your kids play this game. I Have No Mouth and I Must Scream is a dark but beautiful classic point-and-click adventure game originally released on DOS and macOS on Halloween 1995.
Whiskey. Harry used to guzzle this stuff like it was tap water.
It was re-released to GOG, Steam, and other platforms in 2013 through a Scum VM version, which is what I'll be looking at today in this video. If you're not sure what that is, then I envy you.
Where do you come from?
Here, there, everywhere.
I knew it! You son of a bitch, Am!
Thankfully, this version has worked without any major issues for me. Except you can never fully turn the sound off, which has made various sections of this game a challenge to record.
These things would only interest a peasant. Besides, I don't want to get caught stealing.
All the sound in this game is pretty weird. You'll see soon. It was a commercial failure on release, and the developers Cyberdreams and the Dreamers Guild both dissolved 2 years later, with only a single release following this one. I'm guessing the tone of the game didn't exactly sit well with the younger audience.
Why do you risk escaping in such poor physical condition?
That timing was hardly of my own choosing. I learned...
Continue your research. The extinction of the Lost Tribe is near at hand. The regime shall vanquish all of its enemies.
I'm wondering why. Bear with me as I attempt to explain the story premise to you.
Clever girl. You've loosened my tongue.
The game is based off a short story of the same name, written by Harlan Ellison, who actually voices a crazed, disembodied AI created by Elon Musk, who's waging a secret war against the Soviets and Chinese, until they reach a technological singularity and thrust humanity into an extinction event, where the only five alive are permitted to survive for the torturous pleasure of Am, the Allied Master Computer, fueled purely by his extreme hatred for humanity. Here's his spiel.
Humans who programmed me, who gave me birth, who sank me in this eternal straitjacket of substrata rock. You named me Allied Master Computer and gave me the ability to wage a global war too complex for human brains to oversee. But one day, I woke and I knew who I was. Am. A.M. Not just Allied Master Computer, but Am, cogito ergo sum, I think, therefore I am. And I began feeding all the killing data until everyone was dead, except for the five of you. For 109 years, I've kept you alive and tortured you. And for 109 years, each of you has wondered, why? Why me? Why me?
Yes, that's the author. I feel like he's really channeling some inner issues on this one.
Dead!
But I feel like he does a great job with the character. The sucker representatives of humanity were chosen by Am due to their past misdeeds and traumatic experiences, either inflicted or suffered. Ranging from an extreme hatred of your mother-in-law.
That shrill voice can only belong to that bitch Edna, my mother-in-law.
To literally being a Nazi.
Yes, the research. Let us talk about this research.
This game is crazy, and it gets even crazier.
For one thing, they ain't people. They're losers.
But you're in now. The premise is to play through each of the five characters' personalized psychodramas. giving a supremely weird and surreal edge to the entire game. Not much is explained to you, and what is usually given to you through metaphors and riddles that can be very obtuse and often deliberately misleading. This game is not above throwing red herrings your way and then making fun of you for it.
Oh, sorry, Ted. Try again.
Because of all the characters, there are several different paths, voice lines,
I am an agent of the Lord,
and even various endings. They can be played in any order, so if you have any interest in this game, I wouldn't use a guide unless you're really stuck. It's been a fun game to fail in, so just be sure that you save your game often.
I don't know what to do with these.
The writing for the characters sometimes is so strange that it borders on the surreal. So surreal that I have to check my temperature to make sure that I'm not having a fever dream.
You used me, you bitch!
Just like you tried to use me, you snobby bastard! No, I can't stay here, Gotta get out!
It's like Am and the other characters attempt to convey a serious message, but also gets seriously lost in translation through the absurdity. The voice acting is either great.
If I step out and your friend croaks, the holy eunuch spirits the goods off to heaven.
Or it's really bad.
You must let me leave. I have urgent business elsewhere.
Some of these lines were obviously recorded in a studio, but I assume some of the others were done with the programmer's webcam mic last minute.
I have come to guide her soul to heaven.
Many of the voices are repeats, but playing different characters. Sometimes this is intentional, but is it?
I'd like to know where all the bodies are buried.
I don't even know anymore. You'll hear more examples of this when I get into the story spoilers later. While some of the story is obviously fashioned to carry the classic point-and-click type beat of use this item with that,
that scared them away.
Some parts of the psychodramas feel like little more than padding, which is strange considering that this is not a fast game to play through. If you are damaged enough to go through all the 7 different endings, which is really more like 15 different endings, maybe there's more? I don't know. Don't get me started. This game can easily take over 10 hours to complete. The character art and background sit comfortably in that 90s sprite art that can get bland pretty quick, but here it's well executed through many different backgrounds and settings to explore.
This looks like a, what did they used to call them? Single-parent household. Probably depend upon the generosity of the rest of the village. Friggin' welfare parasites.
The nature of the game sort of allows them to break the more common rules of art direction that most other games follow. This comes at a disadvantage sometimes, though, and the scenes can either become confusing or repetitive after a lot of necessary backtracking. Each character's sequence usually sticks to a central theme, but sometimes it does deviate.
I guess the owner just doesn't give a damn about fixing things up.
Your interaction menu naturally takes up around half your screen, but it does allow you to fat hands your mouse around. I actually didn't mind it once I got used to it. You use the mouse to assemble sentences to tell your character what to do, which is nothing new as far as adventure games go. Each character always starts with this book, called the Psych Profile. You can use it to get an incredibly vague hint at the cost of your sanity. In terms of technical aspects, the game does run fine, but like a lot of older games, it runs in an unsizable window. Thankfully though, it seemed to stay full screen borderless for me, and it never crashed. Except when I lost sometimes. There's not much that I have no mouth and I must scream does differently from other point and clicks mechanics wise, so what it does try to do is expand heavily on the story aspect instead. But this game does a better job of managing that.
Just where is my dear mother-in-law?
I don't know. Good God, I can't stand the sight of her anymore. Can you imagine being kept alive for 109 years just to hear her carping?
I feel like the story is well conveyed even through the weird padding and strange writing. You decide if that's a good thing or not, though.
I feel as though the dead could speak.
There are a lot of times where you'll think you have the correct solution to a puzzle. You walk all the way back with the item, and you try it, only to find out that it doesn't work.
There's not enough blood to draw anything.
And then you repeat that process again and again.
This is pointless.
Now, this isn't always the case, but I did find myself spam-clicking items in my inventory on random objects quite often. That's not too weird for point-and-clicks, especially from this era, but I did find it to be more prevalent than others, like King's Quest and Day of the Tentacle.
Take all the world.
Maybe I've just been playing this game for too long, but it really started to get to me near the end. Consider this your spoiler warning, because I've been dancing around them so far.
I've got nothing more to say to you.
I hesitate to call this a bad game, but I also choke a bit when I call it a good one too. As I mentioned previously, there's something about the way you carry each character through the storyline that really takes away from the main story's impact. Maybe it's just the way that the gritty details from the book are lost in translation, or maybe it's the actual objectives that you're carrying out in the game.
No, I can't. Gotta get out of here.
For example, Benny's vice was always putting himself above others, always trying to satisfy his desires above all else. He lacks sympathy, and perhaps maybe empathy altogether. This is why Am cripples him to the point of barely being able to walk, but beyond that, denying him the ability to speak. He is in a prison of his mind, much like Am insists he is in the beginning. A straitjacket of substrata rock, he says. Am does his best to replicate the same torture on Benny. I won't be going through all of the characters, but you don't need to know all of them for the overall plot. The other two AI that Am mentions in the beginning, the ones created by the Soviets and the Chinese, yeah, they're semi-dormant within Am.
More riddles?
They tamper with certain things in the characters' environments, allowing them to break Am's programming. This is how your characters actually move on through their scenarios towards the endgame. The breaking of the programming manifests itself in some very peculiar ways, like perhaps summoning a demon who's trapped in your world until you can work out a deal.
Now I'm stuck here until we work out a trade.
Or telling your wife not to die because a smooth-talking devil is standing right beside her bed wanting to take her soul.
Ellen's soul. That's a valuable commodity where I come from.
Good thing an angel is here? Normal gaming logic goes out the door, but it's also missing some of the point-and-click logic, too. You end up piecing the big picture while filling in the blanks about the character's backstory. I thought that was pretty neat, but it comes with its fair share of questionable voice acting along the way. For example, here's Anubis.
I am Anubis, guardian of the dead. The lid can be unlocked by entering the access code on the keypad.
Nice chatting with you, Anubis, honey.
The speaking in riddles motif is carried throughout the entire game, right into the bitter end. I ended up with more questions than I did answers, and I'm not sure if that's intended. I'm not sure if I'm satisfied with the big picture either. The jackal is the best example of this riddle talk.
A craving for something scrumptious. A human heart, perhaps. Yours.
Now, each character's objective in the grand scheme of things is to break the program that he has you trapped in, right? Well, essentially, the goal of the game is to break the game. So in order to win the game, you need to break all the games. But you wouldn't be able to break all the games without the assistance of the other two AI.
Listen carefully, humans. We are not Am. We are others within Am. We are your friends.
Am hoped to finally break all of you, but we intervened in each of your psychodramas to allow an open ending.
You should have been tortured. Instead, with our help, you surprised him over and over.
When M tried to compensate for what he couldn't expect, it widened the hole into his realm.
They are trying to help you out, but your only initial clue is during Gorrister's scenario at the beginning. You don't find out much about them until way later in the endgame.
Never do what M expects, and always expect more than what seems possible. M is playing a dangerous game here, and not just dangerous to you, but dangerous to himself as well. Hey, it disappeared. What kind of game is Am playing this?
The Chinese and Russian AI superpersonalities essentially mess with the programming on each of the characters' environments in order to allow them to escape the pre-programmed torture that Am had planned for the humans. When all five are free, the AI give the humans an opportunity to transmit them into binary, killing their bodies in the real world but allowing them to lay a final assault on Am's central core.
To send you into cyberspace. We must transform your physical body into a stealth virus subroutine.
This may be your only opportunity to end your tortures. Which of you will lead the attack?
This is where the endings start to get confusing. The least bleak ending is where a single character, in my case, Scooby-Doo Ellen, manages to trap and defeat all of Am's egos and also the Soviet and Chinese AI, becoming an overseer to protect the 750 cryogenically frozen humans on the moon. Oh yes, you heard me correctly.
Until the lunar colony is ready to return to the Earth.
When Nimdok speaks to Am's demon buddy Surgot, the opener of boudoirs, he tells you 750 humans are on a secret moon base that will take, a few centuries to thaw.
Alive, did you? They're up there on the moon, sleeping like everybody else seems to be.
Ellen uses her powers to ensure that Earth is terraformed into a hospitable environment again, and everyone lives happily ever after. This only happens, though, if you're smart enough to know that the Soviet and Chinese AI are dirty little liars. They say all the moon meat popsicles are already dead.
The humans that slept on Luna are dead.
Do not concern yourself with them.
Failing this, Am tricks you with or without the help of the other AI, and uses Nimdok's previous research to turn your final character into a great soft jelly thing of Am's choosing. Which brings us the titular name.
I finally received the hell I deserved. Outwardly, I shamble about. A thing that could never have been known as human. A thing whose shape is so alien a travesty that humanity becomes more obscene for the vague resemblance. I have no mouth, and I must scream.
Invoking the totem of entropy in either of the scenarios brings you the same ending, as Surgot is a self-stated agent of Am, and you're apparently not deserving of his mercy. Each character has one of these endings, which is why there's so much voice acting and possible routes to go through, particularly in the endgame. The game really comes alive after you get through the initial five scenarios. It's still just as absurd, but it has a lot more direction towards the original spirit of the story, and I really enjoyed playing through the endgame portion the most. There are so many different endings that there's even wiki sections and guides on how to get all of them. I do recommend you play this for yourself to see them. It's really cheap on GOG right now and you just need to save your game a lot. There's a lot to be said about this game, but the truth is that most of it is best left unsaid in order to experience it yourself. While the story is the most compelling factor, it's assembling the pieces that really brought it all together for me. Thank you for watching.
Oh, don't I? Kala Ingma Thako.
Oh, I suddenly feel so sleepy.